My guest today is a great chess player. He's a great golfer. He's an ex-banker, but you probably know him best as coach of the New York Jets. The New York Jets is a team that haven't won the Super Bowl since 1969. They haven't been in the playoffs since 2010. But the man today to change all that is sitting with me. I am so pleased to welcome Coach Saleh. Thank you.
No, thank you.
I want to talk about culture, the whole idea of all gas, no breaks. Just tell me what that means to you and what it means to your players.
It's really the idea behind it is to go to bed better than when you woke up. Just to have the mindset to step on the gas of life and maximize who you are. And when you're brushing your teeth at night and looking at that person in the mirror, being satisfied with the idea that you got a little bit better that day.
And the other thing you talk about, which is interesting, is I think you said you have an infatuation with the Navy SEALs.
I just have so much respect for their mindset. And, you know, the idea for me, I'll never put what anyone does on the same level of what they do with regards to them sacrificing for one another, knowing full well that that sacrifice might cost them their life. So many tools that you can take from them, not only from the organizational part, but the mental fortitude and the will to succeed that resides in all of them.
It is a culture that exists here, obviously not at the same level.
People always talk to me about culture, and it's not necessarily, you know, I think it's kind of an overused word.
Yeah.
You know, there's two types of players. There's those who love the game, and there's those who love what the game brings them. And you want the guys who love everything about the process of football, the training, the rehab, the practice, yeah, the pain. If you can just fill your locker room or your whatever business you're in with people who love the idea, that love what they're doing, then they're going to do everything they can to protect
them. So you don't have to be the most naturally gifted team.
No.
To be the winners.
People over talent.
Yeah.
I always believe that.
Something Aaron Rodgers said, and I'm going to mention him, but he said that you need to be in a team where every single player believes that they're going to win the Super Bowl this year. Do you think every player believes they're going to win the Super Bowl this year?
I think so. You know, you add a player like Aaron Rodgers, who's a Hall of Fame talent, to go with what we feel is at least a top 10 defense, and then you mix in all the young guys that we have on offense and the veterans that we've brought in, and yeah, we feel really good about our team, but and all those expectations are great, but none of it matters, which goes all the way back to what are we trying to achieve today in this moment where our feet are.
You've talked a lot about it needs to come from within the players rather than you beating the players over their head. But when you're recruiting players, is that something you can see in the recruitment process?
Through the process of evaluating a player, you're going to talk to coaches, you're going to talk to former teammates, you're going to talk to opponents, you're going to talk to as many people as you can to really get a book on who this is. You know, Nick Saban, the head coach at Alabama, he talks about when people are giving an evaluation on you, the player, they talk about you as an athlete, and then they'll either say and or they'll say but. So this dude is an unbelievable football player, and on top of it, he's a community leader. Yeah, he's unbelievable in the facility. He's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or it's, hey, this dude's an unbelievable football player, but he's a royal pain in the butt. He's just poor locker room habits, poor work habits, poor. So you want to find the guys who when you're writing that report, there's and.
There's a very interesting quote, which I've actually got here, which I'm going to read back to you. I believe that the investment coaches put into players has to be the equivalent of the investment you put into your children, said Saleh, the father of seven. You've got to invest everything you have in your heart and in your soul into those players because they're relying on you to help them to be their absolute best. What should that personal investment look like? And in a way, how can managers of businesses apply that? You've got seven kids. You've got 53 players. You know, to put your heart and soul into that 60 people equally.
Yeah.
It's a tough call.
It's really not in the grand scheme of things. Because we also have position coaches.
Yeah.
And a player wants two things from their coach. They care about whether or not you genuinely care about their well-being off the football field. That they're not just a jersey number. And can you help them make plays on Sunday so they can get paid? A long time ago, I developed a mission statement, a commitment to consistently execute the details required to compete at my greatest level with loyalty and conviction.
Is that's the statement for the team here?
Well, it's my personal statement. Yeah. I share it with the guys, what they can expect from me and what I expect from them. You know, just the Being committed, being consistent, being detailed, competing to win every day, being convicted in what we're doing and having loyalty. But, you know, part of the investment, my loyalty to my family, my those seven kids, is going to be different to the player. And they understand that. So what is the loyalty to a player? The loyalty is that when you're in our presence and you're here and you're in this building and you have a seat and you have a jersey or you have a locker, I'm going to do everything I can to help you achieve whatever it is you were trying to achieve as a football player in this league. And I do think when a player feels that investment, they feel that connection, they feel the care from their coaches. And when it becomes personal, then those two are going to do everything they can to make sure that the other person doesn't fail.
Yeah.
So the idea behind this is to, you know, when you look at starting from here all the way to the end of the hallway, there's naturally these little blocks. If you go all the way through to the end of the wall, it takes you all the way to the Super Bowl. We put up highlights from that particular game or that week. So the idea being, instead of the players just on their phone all the time, we can just get one to look up and say, God, I remember this game, man. I did this, this, and this. Or, God, I remember this game. I could have did this, this, and this better.
Yeah.
Just to get one guy thinking football while he walked down this very long hallway, which they make this trip over and over again.
It's a long hallway.
Very long hallway.
I'm getting knackered.
I know.
I'm tired.
That's why we're in shape. We walk so much.
I play a bit of golf, and I know you're a very good golf, but basically, as soon as you put me in a pressure situation, I cannot hit a ball. You know, you guys are all under a lot of pressure now, you and everybody in the whole team. How do you manage the pressure?
This might help your golf game.
Oh.
Okay, so you said pressure. So there's pressure and there's stress. Those are two completely different things. Stress is a world that you have zero control over. You have just placed, you're sitting over the ball, and you're stressing on the pond, you're stressing on the trees, you're stressing on the bunker. You don't have control of those. Pressure is dominating the things that you have control over. Those are things you've got control over. You got control over making a perfect swing. That's it. Whatever happens after that happens.
What do you love about the game of golf? Because there's so many aspects to it, aren't there? Well, what is it that you love about golf?
You know, I was asked, you know, what's my happy place? Where's the one place on earth where I can just take a deep breath, relax, and be happy? And my answer is on the driving range before I run the golf.
Oh, really?
You know, and it's where the anticipation of the round of playing very well and, you know, just striping the ball and just feeling really good about in that moment.
Rather than the reality of then teeing off and
then everything
killing
falls
a few
apart.
Rabbits.
It's a lifelong sport. And it just feels like no matter how good I do, I feel like, God, I could have shot a 75 if I would have just made this putt or chipped in that one. Or like you could break 80 one round and not break 90 the next round, you know, and it's one of those sports that, you know, you're outside, you're getting sun, you're around people who are important to you, and you're away from society.
Just in terms of your big family, you've got to be pretty fit. What's your exercise regime?
Well, I'm spoiled. I got our strength coach puts me through the ringer every morning.
Really? So it's an hour and a half every morning?
About an hour. So I jump on, you know, I'm a big Peloton guy, so I, you know.
You're a Peloton? Running or cycling?
Cycling and rowing.
Okay, I need to get a rowing Peloton. I need to get a trainer for an hour and a half every morning.
I don't pound the pavement running anymore. My knees and joints hurt too much, but you know, I'll ride for a quick 20 and then I get a quick lift in and, you know, I try to eat very well. The sauna is always a good friend.
Is it good?
Oh yeah, very, very beneficial.
So ice bath afterwards?
Once in a while, but not afterwards.
I've got a few tips there. Next time you see me, I'm going to be skinny as a rake. Growing up, you played a lot of chess. I actually played a lot of chess too, but I think your rating 1950, I think you're slightly better than me.
Somehow, some way, that's gotten, the highest I've ever gotten was around the 1800 range.
Oh, was it?
So
I thought 1950 is pretty impressive.
That's ridiculous.
Okay, but, well, that's an urban myth. Don't break it.
You know, on online chess, you know, I got kids throwing stuff at me, so I'm hanging around the 1500 range now, which is okay, but.
But is it true what they say, that the American football pitch is just a big chessboard?
In a way, yeah, because you have...
Did your chess make you a better coach?
In my imagination, I'd like to think that chess allows for outside-the-box thinking, to think of different angles, to use different pieces. And you're just trying to trap and advance and capture, and you've got to be able to think outside the box and a couple moves ahead and how you want to do things.
Favorite movie of all time?
Gladiator.
We have a saying at work, we don't want to become the fat gladiator, which is quite easy to do. You know, you win everything and then... You start eating a little bit too much, and then somebody comes out and they kill you.
Yeah.
Which player on the team would you trust to babysit your kids?
CJ Mosley.
Right.
Absolutely.
He'll be pleased to hear that.
Yeah, he's the man.
What are your thoughts on going on a darkness retreat?
You know, actually, I went on a 4-day water fast. Right before the draft. Just drank water for 4 days. And anything, you know, I'm very interested in the human body and what it's capable of outside the medical industry. And so I'm, you know, as far as a darkness retreat, I don't know if I'd go on one yet, but I wouldn't put it past myself to do one.
Very good. Coach Saleh, it has been an absolute pleasure.
Pleasure than all mine.
I hope you win the Super Bowl this year.
And you and
many
me both.
Years, many years thereafter.
You and me both.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.